Today I will explain the simulated annealing algorithm. The word annealing comes from metallurgy. In metallurgy, to make really strong metallic objects, people follow a slow and controlled cooling procedure known as annealing. The same can be applied to computer science algorithms. The simulated annealing algorithm is widely applied to solve problems like traveling salesman problem, designing printed circuit boards, for planning of a path for a robot, and in bioinformatics to design three-dimensional structures of protein molecules. To better explain the algorithm, I have here with me a toy game known as water bubble rings. So this is a small water container that has these plastic rings inside and had some hooks as well. It also comes with these two buttons which can be pressed. So when we press the button, the rings move inside the water. Obviously, the objective in this game is to get as many rings hooked as we can. So how would someone play this game? If we were to play it, how would we play it? Intuitively, we will first start by pressing the buttons vigorously and by checking to see if we can get all the rings hooked, or checking to see if we can get as many rings hooked as we can without worrying about the solution. So that's how we will start. And once we have some rings hooked in the hooks, we will be more careful after that. We'll be more deliberate and we'll play more seriously. As we get closer to the final solution, we will be very careful, very deliberate, and our final moves will be extremely carefully planned. So that's the intuition behind the simulated annealing algorithm. At the beginning, you don't care if you're actually moving towards a good solution. You accept bad moves as well. You accept bad configurations as well. But as you progress towards the solution, we become more careful and we try to get closer to the solution by selecting only the good moves. So to formulate any problem in order to apply algorithms like simulated annealing, every problem needs to have a way to define how good a given configuration is. So for this particular game, for this particular toy, given a configuration of this toy, we can tell how good the solution is by checking the number of rings that are hooked, right? So every system or every problem that we are solving needs to have a way to describe the goodness of the fitness of the solution for the problem. In other words, we need to, in optimization problem, it's also known as the energy of the solution. In other words, we need to have a mechanism to define the energy of the system. So if E is the energy of the system, we represent the energy using E. And once we have a mechanism to compute E, we can also compute delta E, or the change in energy. So every time the system goes through a change of configuration, we can compute the change in energy. Now, talking about this game, when somebody is playing this game, one can play it in a specific way. So someone can focus in just one of the hooks and continue to play the game so that he or she can get as many rings as possible hooked in one of the hooks, forgetting about the remaining hooks. Now, if we play like that, after a certain time, we will end up in a deadlock where we have lot of rings hooked in one of the hooks, but the other hooks are empty. At that point, if you play vigorously, you will remove a lot of the rings which I already saw. And if you play very slow, it will take a really long time to get to the final solution. So situations like that in optimization problem are known as a local maxima or local minima. So if we were to plot all possible configurations of a given system in x-axis, and in y-axis, we were to compute the corresponding energy of all the configurations, then the energy landscape usually looks something like this. So higher values correspond to maximum energy. In our case, since we want maximum number of rings to be hooked, it's a maximization problem, and we want the maximum value of energy for our problem. And places like this in the energy landscape, which look like higher value in energy, but which actually take us to this deadlocks, are known as a local maxima. or if we are trying to minimize the energy, then these are also known as local minima. And the actual energy that we want, or the configuration that we want, where we have the maximum energy, is known as a global maxima, if we are trying to maximize. So this is something that we need to be vigilant about when we are applying algorithms like this to solve a problem, is to be careful and to check if we are actually being stuck in a local minima, or we are actually getting closer to the global maxima, global minima. Now, once we have a way to define energy, once we know about local minima and local maxima, we also need a way in which we can change the configuration of a system every time. So in the water bubble rings game, in the story, we can change the configuration by pressing the button, right? So it randomly alters the configuration of the system so that we get a new configuration. So every problem where we apply algorithms like this needs to have a mechanism to alter the configuration. So if C is the current configuration, we need to have a mechanism to alter the current configuration to the next configuration, N. And usually this is also known as making a move. In the water bubble rings, we make it just by pressing the button. So once we have these definitions laid out, now I would like to explain the simulative annealing algorithm. So the idea is to start with the initial configuration, or given random configuration. Then we introduce a variable known as temperature. Just the way in case of annealing, we start with initial high temperature and we slowly controlled cool the material, which for the algorithm we start with a maximum temperature Tmax. And this is a monotonically decreasing function that slowly decreases to Tmin or minimum temperature. So for every value of temperature, we first compute the current energy of the system for the current configuration EC. Then we change the configuration, or alter the configuration a little bit using the technique for altering the configuration, and then we get the next configuration N. And we compute the energy for this new configuration EM. Once we have EC and EM, we compute delta E, or change in energy. And so now we have old configuration C, or the current configuration C, and the new configuration N, and we know the change in energy. Since we are working on the maximization problem, if delta E is positive, or the change in energy is a good one, if it's a good move, we accept the move. In other words, we set the next configuration to the current configuration and we accept the move. And we repeat the process so that we are getting closer to the, we are getting a better solution and we move closer to the final solution. At every step, if we see that the change in energy is negative, or in other words, if we are making a bad move, then what do we do? So in cases like this, we compute this probability. I'll get to the detail of this, but we compute the probability of this. And then if we see that the probability is very high, then we accept the move, even if it is a bad move. And if the probability is low, then we have low probability to accept the bad move. So this probability depends on these two variables, the change in energy delta E and the temperature factor T. When temperature is very high, then the probability for accepting the bad move becomes very high. In other words, at high temperatures, we are exploring the solution space, or we are exploring the configurations, and we are accepting bad moves as well. And when the temperature is low, this probability becomes very low, and we have very low probability to accept bad moves. Say, for instance, when temperature is very high, say 10,000, and change in energy is a normal value, say 100 or 10, then this whole thing computes to a small negative number. E to the power of a small negative number gives you something very close to 1. And so a number that is close to 1 has a very low probability to become greater than a random number between 0 and 1, right? So, which means we get a very high probability. So when temperature is very high, we have high probability to accept bad moves as well. Now, we also see that the change in energy delta E also influences it. So if the change in energy is very high, we again have very low probability to accept the move. And when the change in energy is small, we have high probability to accept the move. So this is how the whole algorithm works. So we repeat the process for a certain number of times, usually known as the number of epochs, usually 100 to 200 times. And for every value of temperature, we repeat the process, and finally expecting the solution to converge towards the global minimum. So that's the idea behind the algorithm. Now, on either extremes are two other algorithms known as hill climbing and random walk. So, if we remove the probability factor or the temperature factor and you always accept the good moves only, then that's hill climbing, or it's like a greedy algorithm, you always go towards a better solution. Such algorithms are prone to easily be stuck in local minima. On the other end is a random walk, which means we don't care about how good a move we are making every time, but we just continue to explore the space. Such algorithms never converge and will probably never give you the best optimal solution. Now, the parameters Tmax, Tmin, and number of epoch are dependent on the problem that we are solving. Usually people start with high temperatures like a few thousand, like say 3,000 or 5,000, and the minimum temperature is set to a small value like 0 or 10 or something like that. Number of epoch is usually 100, 200, depending on the problem. So these are the parameters that you can explore by applying the algorithm to the problem that you have. And if you run it multiple times, you will have an idea of whether you are being stuck in the local minima or you're heading towards the global minima. Thank you.